My name is Bradford Young. I'm a cinematographer. I'm a father. I'm a lover of movies and art, but I'm also a huge fan of an admirer of three cats that are on this call. Two of them here in person, one in spirit. So I'll start with the one in spirit because we're here to honor this person more than anybody, who is Mr. Fred Hampton, who's, as far as I'm concerned, has been a hero of mine since I was, before I was born. My father's from Chicago, born in Bronzeville, a child of the Great Migration, a member of the Mickey Cobra family, who got gang affiliated his whole life. And if you're gang affiliated your whole life and you're from Chicago, there's no way Fred Hampton was not your hero, somebody you adored. And my relationship with Fred Hampton started with my father, who was admired and totally enamored by this young spirited person. So before there was Marvel comic books and other stories to inspire me, Fred Hampton has been in my collective consciousness and my family for a very, very long time. So I just thought I'd mention that and remind us that that's what we're here to talk about. We're here to talk about two wonderful filmmakers who I admire equally. One being Mr. Sean Bobbit, who has spent the last decade inspiring me with every film that he's photographed. No loose ends, nothing not tight, nothing not thought out, intentionality painted all over the screen. Plus, I like his accent and the fact that he lives on a houseboat. But he has literally collaborated with some of the most important filmmakers, period, ever. And it makes sense, based on his body of work, that he would collaborate with a person of my generation, a person I consider to be my brother, somebody who I hugely admire, somebody who I look towards for leadership, not only as a filmmaker, but as a human being. Somebody I know was forged under a beautiful fire, forging a beautiful fire by his wonderful parents. Somebody who I cannot wait to see what they make next, because his voice is so important in our time, Mr. Shaka King. So I'm so happy to be in conversation with you two, because there's no two filmmakers now, especially with the film that you've made, that is was a great joy and mystery, and I could not wait to see it. And we waited and we waited and we waited. It finally came, and we were not disappointed by one second. I mean, I think the first thing I want to just ask is this is really for, you know, Shaka, because I think it's important for us, for everybody here to understand how the collab, not necessarily how the collaboration came about, but like, I think people forget that, like, being a director is a curatorial position. You actually have to curate every element. Every person that you bring to the table has to be taken under the specific kinds of consideration has to be taken in order for that person. I know you, so I know that. Just walk me through why, more than anything, I guess the question is, like, why did this collaboration makes sense between you and Sean? Why did this collaboration make sense for this story? You know what I mean? For this specific story, you know, why did it make sense?
You know, I remember presenting 200 to 300 photographs that Akeem gave me to Sean, and Sean looking at those, and instantly I already was like, I think this is the movie. He was like, absolutely. He was like, this is what we're following. It was a combination of that. It was just the energy that, you know, I could pick up on just sitting across from him, that, you know, we had a similar temperament and openness to, you know, obviously preparing. We were going to prepare. You know, he could tell from meeting me that I was a person who prepared. You know, upon getting to know him, I could tell that he was the person who prepared, but that we were also open to our intuition and the act of creation also leading us and giving us gifts. I could tell that he was that kind of artist as well. Also, it really excited me that he'd been a news cameraman And he spent time in Chicago in the 80s or 90s, I believe you said, Sean. And just that kind of just like that kind of understanding of realism that we were attempting to recreate with this film. And it made sense to me looking at his body of work, you know, it all feeling incredibly real and beautiful and stylized, but never distractingly so. Always in service of not just the story, but the truth. And so all of those things in combo, it just was like, yeah, I mean, this is the way forward.
You know, when I see all the films that I really respect and the choices you've made, you know what I mean? The choices you've made really kind of express your own curatorial process. So can you explain to me when you read the script, like what made you, or you met Shaka, what made you understand in your own, under your own process of deciding what you do, what your next film you're going to do, what made this the right choice for you at that time?
Well, first off, thank you both for those kind words. I mean, I am blushing at this point. I wish, you know, well, just thank you. You know, that you're very kind. You know, when I read a script, the first thing that matters to me, I don't think of images, I don't think about, you know, shooting or anything. I just think, is it interesting and does it affect me? Is there an emotional, a pure, simple emotional effect here? And if it has an emotional effect, in this script, absolutely, I was in tears at the end of it, and also so shocked and appalled and horrified and, you know, just angry at the whole, you know, the, just what they did and how they did it. And, you know, all the hypocrisy that goes before that and everything else. It just sort of, you know, having come from news and documentaries, I've seen that stuff all over the world. And, you know, that's not supposed to happen in America. You know, it's the land of the free, home of the brave. And there's so much that's been hidden about American history. Then when I met Shaka, you know, it was obvious. His passion, his knowledge, his personal aura. There's a calmness there, but there's also a humor and also, you know, an absolute focus.
Give me an example or give us a story or something that where you all had to arrive, you know, you showed up to shoot something and it wasn't necessarily a technical challenge, but maybe it was clear from pre-production on, like, what was the spiritual? What were those moments where you had to like spiritually get in gear, even though you had done all the research, you had all the 300 images, all those, it's more than a notion, because when you show up, you still have to get through all of the things that are in front of you to really do a moment, a service, you know, be in service of a moment and not be a disservice of a moment. So
for me, that's pre-production. And that's building the relationship with the director and understanding, you know, where the true emotion is in the story and also in the person of the director, and trying to get into tune with that and incorporate that, you know, as a vital element of the overall look of the film, you know. And it's always trying to find what's in you that you can bring to the project.
Right.
What you bring has to be directed.
Yes.
You know, and that's, you know, you mentioned the leader and leadership. And that is such an important and so often overlooked thing. And that's something that Shaka naturally has.
With Judas, what strikes me about it is something Shaka and I talked about right after I saw it. And of course, I read it in the script, which is like this fine balance. And this kind of, for me, is, I'm curious to hear you all sort of flex on the characters of it all, the performance of it all, and why, how that informs the visual style. But for me, what's so beautiful about Judas is the fine balance between an intense love story, which for me is the thing that I connected to the most. So I'm curious to see, just understand how that, knowing that you have to be that close to characters in order to get that story across, like how does that number one, inform how you engage with actors, you know what I mean? And how you allow those beautiful performances we see to shine without getting in, without the visual style getting in the way, but how you measure still making it look like something, but at the same time, making sure we never forget this is a character driven story. You know what I mean? Like, how do you balance that directorially? And how do you balance that as a cinematographer?
Well, as a cinematographer, it's actually quite easy. I treat the actors with utmost respect and try and ensure that the camera and the crew is never in their way, and to try and ensure that everything is ready for them when they arrive, that the space is right for hanging, you know, and I say, just don't take up their time. Give them as much time and space, and also disappear. Just don't engage, because it's, you know, you're not a distraction. The whole crew, the camera, everything else is an edifice. You want to do away with that edifice. You want to do away with that artifice of it, and literally try and hide everything so that they are able to just be in that space and that time, and to do what they need to do. Mm. So, and it's also, I will never talk to a director or to an actor. That's the director's job. And so it's ensure that you never get in between the director and the actors.
Mm. You know, I think it helps that with both the movies, the features I made, I had too much story and I hate exposition. So because you have so much plot and I also hate exposition, the storytelling becomes about very small, intimate moments and being very specific and intentional about what every scene means. And in turn, that trickling down to each department so that they're highlighting with their work all of the subtext that's contained in those scenes. You really have to just be very purposeful. It's like, it has to be love at first sight. You know what I'm saying? That's because we got to get there, you know? So you have to see them vibing in a major way in that first interaction. When she leaves him, he has to look at her in such a way where you know she's going to come back. We went into this movie kind of thinking the genre of it all would be the frosting and the sprinkles, you know, and the sustenance would be the Fred Hampton story. But when you cast great actors, you find that you have great set pieces just in two people interacting in the room. You don't need the bells and whistles of crazy plot and gunfire. And, you know, that's why you look at the trailers. The trailers are anchored in dramatic scenes, very simple scenes, a speech, a man and a woman together, and a woman reading a poem to her man. Understanding coming into this, we're making these movies within the movie. How is this, how do we, in this scene, how do we make this, how do we shoot the graphic novel versus how do we shoot the intimate love story, you know?
You know, I know I can say this, I can't speak for everybody, but I know I can speak for Shaka, as you know, all of our friends in this 5-block radius here in Baltimore who really adore you and love you. That, you know, we're super proud of you, and you have, and as your parents, I know, as your mother and father would say, you have done us well. And we cannot wait for you to continue to be the artist that you are, you know what I mean? Very, and Judas and the Black Messiah really, really gave us a lot, fed us, you know, and we're thankful for you, but we're also thankful for this collaboration. And Sean, thank you for understanding that cinematography isn't just about lining up a bunch of people and a bunch of faces and just aiming a camera at them and shooting them. thank you. You know, thank you. And again, thank you for, again, both of you teaching me again, another moment of learning, you know, showing me how it's done. You know what I mean? Showing what standard you have to bring to the table and the bar that you have to set in order to really tell these stories in the way that, as it's clear now, is speaking to so many people. So just thank you, you know, thank you for letting me ask you crazy questions. I appreciate it.
Thank you for doing this, Brad. Thank you, man. Thank you so much.
Ain't nothing.
Thank you so much, bro.
All good.